around in 57 when we made it. You know, when the manager saw the film, he thought that maybe they should put speed bumps in the aisle to keep the walkout slow. But the picture through the years have sort of created new audiences. And, you know, we always wish that they had been around at the beginning. But I guess it takes time for films to catch on. So we're grateful, when I say we are, speaking for Stanley as well, that there's an interest in the film and that everybody came here to see it. Probably some of you have seen it before, but it hopefully will entertain you a second time. Anyway, I don't want to waste your time now. We can talk about this later. Let's get on with the movie.
Suggest what you can do with that promotion.
Colonel Dax, you will apologize at once or I shall be placed under arrest.
I apologize for not being entirely honest with you. I apologize for not revealing my true feelings. I apologize, sir, for not telling you sooner that you're a degenerate, sadistic old man. And you can go to hell before I apologize to you now or ever again.
Since the publication of the book 25 years ago, no one dared to make this movie. It was too shocking, too frank.
What sort of casualties do you anticipate, sir?
Say 5% killed by our own barrage. It's a very generous allowance. 10% more in getting through no man's land, and 20% more getting through the wire. That leaves 65%, with the worst part of the job over. Let's say another 25% in actually taking the anthill. We're still left with a force more than adequate to hold it.
General, you're saying that more than half my men will be killed.
Aside from the inescapable fact that a good many of your men never left the trenches, there's the question of the troops' morale. Don't forget that.
The troops' morale, sir?
Certainly. These executions will be a perfect tonic for the entire division. There are few things more fundamentally encouraging and stimulating than seeing someone else die.
Where in heaven's name are they?
On the left.
Where are the rest? 0+1 and they're still in the trenches. They're not advancing. Miserable cowards. They're not advancing. The barrage is getting away from them. They're still in the trenches.
Yes.
Captain Nichols.
Yes, sir?
Order the 75s to commence firing on our own positions.
But while we were there, we were developing this script on Fez and Laura. We started with Jim Thompson, who worked with us on Killing, which was the first film that we had done together. And so we put Jim Thompson on Fez and Laura to write the first script. We had been working with Paul Willingham on a project at MGM. So when Stanley and I were fired from MGM, and Jim Thompson had finished the work that he had done on the script of Fez and Laura, we then put Calder Willingham on the Fez and Laura script to rewrite Jim Thompson. And then Stanley would rewrite both. I'm being a bit facetious on the rewriting. It wasn't done that way, actually. But we had contributions from the book, of course, Hungry Ghost, a book. And we had Jim Thompson, who's terrific for dialogue. For instance, the dialogue where Ralph Meeker comes back from the patrol and he confronts Wayne Mars with his cowardice. He says that he has a bottle for a brain. And the street instead of a spine over yes. That's typical Jim Thompson, a great crime writer. And then comes Paul Willingham, who's more sophisticated and gets more into the political aspects of him. So that was the thing, how the script got developed. However, when we had to make a choice on who's going to play the role of Colonel Dax, our first choice was Kirk Douglas. And Kirk read the script and said that he really liked the script. He loved to do this, but he was committed to do a stage play in New York, and that he felt obliged to live up to his obligations, and unfortunately had to reject our offer. So we where were we going to go from here? We tried bringing me back. Just about everybody. We even got so desperate that we tried Jeff Chandler. I don't know if you remember Jeff Chandler. He was called the man with great final head. But Jeff Chandler's agent wouldn't even let me read the script. When he read the script, he thought it was so depressing and so downbeat. And so on Hollywood, no women in the picture. He did us a great favor because Kirk, for some reason, the New York play didn't develop, and Kirk suddenly became available. And that, of course, was our first choice to begin with. And we jumped on that opportunity. We felt so strongly about it that we agreed to some of these harsh terms that the representatives of Kirk Douglas enforced on these two kids that were desperate to get a film made. I'm sure the filmmakers out there in the audience, and you know how tough it is to get a film made. It's almost impossible. And to have a major star whose attachment would certainly take you a long way towards getting the financing, and we couldn't let that slip through our fingers. So we agreed to do five films for Kirk Douglas' company called Rhino, of which Kirk wanted to be in two of the films. But we had to do that, and we felt that we worried about this sort of lifetime commitment at some later date. But in the meantime, we got Kirk. Now, Kirk had the power. He was doing a picture in the future for United Artists called The Vikings. And so he took the script to United Artists because we had done the Killing with United Artists financing. And so we went back to UA. This time we went back with Kirk Douglas. And Kirk Douglas talked them into it, really. Nobody would want to do this picture. Then why would they? They want to do flag waving pictures. They want to do pictures that glorify war. That's what the general public, can get off on, seeing that stuff. But Kirk threatened that he would pull away the Vikings, which they thought was a big money picture. turned down because it's lovely, so they need me to do it. You know, limited budget. I had to worry about, you know, guaranteeing the permission and things like that. And the script, believe it or not, had a happy ending, which of course was greatly appreciated by United Artists. They, of course, always want happy endings. I can't even imagine us doing that, but we agreed to do that.
This is a last minute kind of revision that you submitted to UA after you'd already done the harsh ending with the execution on it.
Well, yeah. You know, the book has been executed. And of course, that's, but we felt we couldn't get the picture made if it didn't have the man saved in the end. And of course, we felt, what's the point of the picture? If you save the man, you're not really making your point. However, we put everything together and packed up our bags and we moved to Germany to make the film. Now, Stanley and Cole Willingham went on ahead to Munich, and Kirk and I stayed back here, and Kirk and I were having discussions and so forth, and we were, supposedly, Kirk believed that I was sending on to Stanley things that Kirk and I were drumming up. But speaking of drumming up, Kubrick, of course, being so unhappy with the ending the way it was trying to find a way to make it at least palatable. And so he and Cole Willingham were revising the end of the script. So when Kirk and I arrived, in fact, I got there maybe a day or two ahead of Kirk, and he showed me the script of the new Kubrick-Willingham arrangements. I really didn't think it worked. You know, I just thought that you know, you can't make good mayonnaise out of rotten eggs, you know? And there's no way you can take something that's bad to begin with and as talented as Stanley and Volker are. It just, they were too close to it at this point. And so I really feared that when Kirk came over and he saw this, it was going to be all today. This is something he's never seen before. And I knew what my reaction to it was, so I assumed this was going to be pretty much the same, which, of course, was the case. And we had a terrible day where Stan and I were at the studio, only get the call from Eric, who I had picked up at the airport the night before, and he insisted on getting the script. And I said, well, Kirk, why don't you wait a while, and, you know, get a good night's sleep, maybe tomorrow. So give me that script now. So Stanley and I, the next morning, we're at the studio. We get the call. You guys better come over here right away. And I said, oh, Christ, you know, this is going to be tough. And rapidly, he's at the Fairgarten Hotel in Munich. And we're up at his suite. And he let us have it. And then we said, look, you want to do this? Yeah, you do it. I'm going home. It's panic time. Now, when United Artists finances a picture in those days, and there's pre-production, and there's a lot of money spent already, but when they give you money towards the budget of the picture, you sign a note for this. In other words, you're borrowing this money until the picture is made. Because if anything happens, they want their money back. Now, if Kirk leaves, they're already in hundreds of thousands of dollars. How am I going to give that back to UA? And who are we going to get to replace him on the same level as this major star? We knew what trouble we had when Kirk wasn't available. We couldn't find anybody to do it. So, I remember Colin Willingham giving Stanley and I a lecture on integrity and saying, you've got to stand by your guns. You know, to stand by this, you know, I mean, what are you talking about? Oh, you know, we got to do what we have to do and let them go home. And I said, are you kidding? I mean, are you out of your mind? We've got to So Stan and I went out to dinner. Got a bit of a cold. And said, look, we've got to come up with something. We can't really care about home. It's a disaster. So we started to think about the book. We started to think about the real meaning of the picture. It doesn't have the same message. I mean, we want a message is that war is hell, and war shouldn't happen, and terrible things happen in war. And so we looked at each other and we said, the men have to die. And Kirk loved it. I mean, he had to love it because Kirk basically was a good guy. And Kirk basically wants the best for the film. And he immediately saw that this is the way to be honest, this is the way to tell the story properly. Humphrey Carr wrote the book that way. Let's do it. Okay, great. Now what am I going to do? You know, it always seems the picture has a happy ending. So, at this point, I cannot tell United Artists the truth. I said, you know what I'll do? We'll send them the complete script with a new ending. These guys never read scripts. If you send them just the pages, just the last five pages of the ending, which shows the men are executed, they might read that because it's five pages. But you send them the full script. And you go on record in the letter saying, here in post, please find the final screenplay of There's a War. And you know they're going to put it in their desk and go on, they've got a million other things. There's a glory couple, it's a little picture to them. And I just have to cross my fingers when the day of reckoning comes when we screen the picture. But, you know, they're not going to kill me. And so we just trusted. That our instinct was right, that these executives are too busy to get into, actually reading the scripts. I mean, it's 120 pages or something. They're not going to read it. Okay. Now Stanley's got this great idea. In the meantime, when he got over there, he met this girl. He's now he's got a girlfriend he's taken out for dinner. He said, you just saw her. He had this great idea. He said, you know the picture needs a button. It needs a, something more at the end. I said, really? What? And he said, how about they get a German girl somehow, and before they go out into battle, the German girl is forced to sing a song. I said, are you kidding? What is it, turning this into a musical? He said, no, believe me, this is going to put the final touches, it's going to be beautiful. And I said, well, what about, we're going to get an actress? He said, well, I got just the right person. And I said, I can't believe that this is Kubrick, he wouldn't do anybody a favor if he heard the picture. How can you possibly suggest a girlfriend for the scene? He says, no, believe me. He said, I'll tell you what I'll do. Let's shoot the scene. And if you don't like it, we won't use it. But it can't be more fair than that. Then I started to think about it. And said, we're now making a movie, and it's going to be one of the last things we do as a picture. And I'm starting to really feel he was right, that he may be onto something here. As a matter of fact, I wound up conducting the men's singing. I was so into women that I was part of helping. Now, Christiana was her happy name was Susan Christian, but her real name is Christiana Harlan. And her uncle was this incredible Nazi to Jesus. Thanks, boys.
Yeah.
And you're up against the Bridge Over the River Kwai, too, and Oscar.
Yeah, so we start screening the picture around Hollywood, you know, a buzz is going about the picture, but the River Kwai came out of the same year, and of course they awarded all the Oscars, we didn't get anything from this picture, nothing, zero, no nominations on it for anybody. If nothing else, George Grassel, the cinematographer, which is our film. I'm looking at this thing now, shot it in 57. Christ, it looks beautiful. I mean, I know it's a revived, they revived it in prints and negative and all of that, but even so, it's incredible. I mean, the way Stanley worked with him and instead of all those setups and the lighting and so forth.
And those great reverse tracking shots that are going through the trenches, I mean, that's very innovative for its time, and it's magnificent the way that's carried over. What are your aspirations as a producer? What was the, was that due to you too, or were you having to trust Stanley's judgment on that?
My reaction was, how much is this going to cost? No, I'm kidding. I'm not one of those kind of producers. Listen, we always stay on budget. We always stay. You know, Stanley's getting a bum rap of people that think he's like self-indulgent and that he shoots forever. We made The Killing for $330,000 in 24 days. We made this picture for 900 and something thousand for 66 days. But we got to Lolita, then we were up to 88 days. and Stanley's getting more set, prominent, more successful, and can dictate, better terms and better, bigger budgets and better schedules. As soon as I saw the trenches and the moving cameras and all this, we had to make the trenches a little bigger than life. They're not that big. We checked out what they're really like. You can't get a dolly through them. So we had to.
Who's going to know the difference? Everybody talks about those great moving shots. The picture opens in New York, at Christmas time, it's pretty good.
Yeah.
And then picking up they open the picture here, I always get concerned about how it's going to do, So I would call the box office to find out, what's going on. So I called the box office and they said, what time is the next performance of Beth and Lori? And she says, what time do you need down here? So I knew, very mentally. It was banned in France, it was banned in Spain, until you got rid of the Gaulle and Franco, things wouldn't fly. But you just have to be glad that you had an opportunity to make it, and what's next? And what's next? Lolita, and Strange Love, and Stanley's a champ.